Hi students, all of you, good morning and good afternoon. Welcome to the class. In this class, we are going to discuss some CET, NEET and JEE model previous year's MCQs. If you can solve the previous year's MCQs, you will get an idea which type of concepts will be asked for KSET or NEET or JEE, right? So from your material, just a minute, ma. From your material, please see the page number 51, and in that 51 page number, the previous year's questions, the first one, the first question, I'm not going to discuss in this class because they are the questions for JEE. Wherever the calculation part is there, the calculation part containing questions will be asked mainly for JEE. So today we are going to discuss conceptual oriented questions from the previous years. Question number two. Read the question number two. Which of the following is not possible? Quantum numbers are given here. Option A, small n is equal to 3, small l is equal to 0. Question number two. Option A, small n is equal to 3, small l is equal to 0, small m is equal to 0. Option B, small n is equal to 3, small l is equal to 1, small m is equal to minus 1. Option C, small n is equal to 2, small l is equal to 0, small m is equal to minus 1. And option D, small n is equal to 2, small l is equal to 1, small m is equal to minus 1. What are the quantum numbers given here? Principal quantum number, small n. Azimuthal quantum number, small l. Magnetic quantum number, small m. We know that small l value is always lesser than small n value. Simply we can write small l value always lesser than small n value. So in the first option, l is equal to 0, n is equal to 3. It will exist because small l is less than small n. L is equal to 1, n is equal to 3. It will exist. L is equal to 0, n is equal to 2. It will exist. L is equal to 1, n is equal to 2. It will exist. So if we compare only principal quantum number and azimuthal quantum number, all the four quantum numbers are going to exist. But when we go for the magnetic quantum number value, magnetic quantum number values starts from minus L to plus L. Once again, the magnetic quantum number values starts from minus L to plus L. Yes. Now, if I go to the third option, that is a C, small L is equal to 0 is given. When small L is equal to 0, just tell me, what should be the small m value? Text me your response. When the azimuthal quantum number small l is equal to 0, what should be the m value? Yes, magnetic quantum number value should be 0. But in the option C, azimuthal quantum number is given as 0, but magnetic quantum number is given as minus 1. Whether this condition can exist or not? Option C, whether this condition can exist or not? This condition does not exist because here L is equal to 0 is given, then M should be 0, but here M is given as minus 1. So which condition is not going to exist? Option C is the condition that is not going to exist for any of the electron. So that is about the option. Option C is the correct one. Yes, next page. Question number 3. Yes, read the question once. Question number 3. First, read the question and see the options. Try to understand the question. Which of the following represents noble gas configuration? Which of the following represents
noble gas configuration. Yes, in the periodic table, the elements are classified into how many groups and how many periods means 7 periods and 18 groups are present in the periodic table. How many elements are classified? The total 118 elements. They are classified into 7 periods and 18 groups. If we go to the 18th group, what are the 18th group elements? If we go to the 18th group elements, what are the 18th group elements? The 18th group elements are helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. Once again, helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. Helium electronic configuration is 1s2. Neon electronic configuration is, of course, before that we have to write 1s2, but here I am writing only the outer shell electronic configuration. Just I am writing only the outer shell electronic configuration. Outer shell electronic configuration is called as, valency shell electronic configuration. Outer shell configuration is known as valency shell electronic configuration. So we are going to know about the valency shell electronic configuration of 18th group elements. Helium contain only 2 electrons. So the valency shell configuration of helium is 1s2. Whereas neon is going to contain how many electrons? 10 electrons. So among the 10 electrons, 2 electrons are present in the first shell. Remaining 8 electrons are present in the second shell. That is 2s2, 2p6 is the outer shell electronic configuration of neon. So like that, for argon, the outer shell electronic configuration is 3s2, 3p6. For the krypton, the outer shell electronic configuration is 4s2, 4p6. For the xenon, the outer shell electronic configuration is 5s2, 5p6. For the radon, the outer shell electronic configuration is 6s2, 6p6. So these are the outer shell electronic configurations of 18th group elements. And except of helium, excluding the helium, if we observe neon to radon, the outer shell electronic configuration is containing how many electrons? 2 electrons in S subshell, 6 electrons in P subshell. 2 electrons in S subshell, 6 electrons in P subshell. 2 electrons in S subshell, 6 electrons in P subshell. So total 8 electrons are present. 8 electrons are present in the outer shell electronic configuration or valency shell electronic configuration of 18th group. S orbital. S orbital is means only one orbital is present. 2 electrons are present in the S subshell, S2. And P subshell. P subshell contain how many orbitals? 3 orbitals. And the P subshell is having how many electrons? 6 electrons. So we are going to write the 6 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 electrons. So S2, P6. This is the electronic configuration. Having 8 electrons in the valency shell configuration is called as octet electronic configuration. That is the completely filled electronic configuration. Here the S orbital is completely filled, P orbitals are completely filled. We already know that completely filled containing shells or the orbitals or containing the atoms are more stable. Once again, the completely filled subshells containing atoms are more stable. So what are more stable?
helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon, all these are more stable. More stable means that non-reactive. Non-reactive means noble. So, and all these are present in the gaseous state. So these are called as simply noble gases. So which group elements are called as noble gases? 18th group elements are called as noble gases. What are those gases? Means helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. Except of helium, remaining neon to radon, all those atoms of the elements, the valence shell are going to contain 8 electrons. The 8 electrons configuration is called as octet electronic configuration. Octet electronic configuration is indicating all the valence shell orbitals are completely filled. Such atoms are more stable, that are non-reactive, hence they are called as noble gases. Now, coming to the question. See the question number 3. Question number 3, if you see the options, option A, B, C, D. Yes, tell me which option is correct. Which option is correct? Yes, if you see the first option, if you go for the option number 1, is it option number 1? Yes, correct. If you go for the option number 1, that is option A. If you go for option A, there you can find this electronic configuration. 5s2, 5p6 electronic configuration. Please remember, it is very, very important element. Xenon, X-E. The spelling is X-E-N-O-N, xenon. Xenon is the noble gas. What is the outer shell electronic configuration? 5s2, 5p6. Actually, to write the 5s2, 5p6, to write the 5s2, 5p6 electronic configuration in the valency shell, if we want to write 5s2, 5p6, in the valency shell, we have to fill the inner shells. How we have to fill the inner shells? Yes, we know the filling of electrons with the help of Euler diagram. 1s, 2s2p, 3s3p, 4s3d, 4p, 5s, 4d, 5p, 6s, 4f, 5d, 6p, and so on. So first, 1s orbitals are filled first. That is 1s2. Next, 2s orbitals are filled. 2s2. Next, 2p orbitals are filled. 2p6. Next, 3s orbitals are filled. 3s2. Next, 3p orbitals are filled. 3p6. Next, 4s orbitals are filled. 4s2. Next, 3d orbitals are filled. 3d10. Next, 4p orbitals are filled. That is 4p6. Next, 5s orbitals are filled. That is 5s2. Next, 4d orbitals are filled. That is 4d10. Next, 5p orbitals are filled. That is 5p6. So, this is the complete electronic configuration of xenon. So then we can say that 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p6, 5s2, 4d10, 5p6. Now my question is, if you see this electronic configuration, can you say which is the valency shell electronic configuration? What is the valency shell electronic configuration? Here, how many shells are present in the xenon? First of all, in the xenon, how many shells are present? How many orbits are present? In the xenon, how many orbits are present? 5 orbits are present. First orbit is containing 1s2. Second orbit is containing 2s2, 2p6. Third orbit is containing 3s2, 3p6, 3d10. Fourth orbit is containing 4s2, 4p6, 4d10. Fifth orbit is containing 5s2, 5p6. So the valency shell electronic configuration of xenon is 5s2, 5p6. My dear students, if you see the valency shell electronic configuration, what we are writing here? What is the valency shell electronic configuration of xenon?
Valency shell electronic configuration of xenon is Yes, what is the valency shell electronic configuration? 5s2 5p6. Yes, of course all of you know. Now I am saying that how many elements are present in the periodic table? How many elements are present in the periodic table? 118 elements are present. How many groups are there? How many groups are there? The periodic table is containing 18 groups. How many periods are there? How many periods are there? The total elements, 118 elements are there. They are classified into 18 groups and 7 periods. Now my question is, if you see the periodic table in the textbook, if you see the periodic table, xenon belongs to which group? Xenon belongs to which group? Yes. Here you can see the valency shell configuration. 5s2, 5p6. 5s2, 5p6. Here 2 plus 6, 8 electrons are there. 8 electrons are there. The valency shell is containing how many electrons? The valency shell is containing how many electrons? The xenon valency shell is containing how many electrons? 8 electrons. So now we can say that it is the Roman number 8th group. Roman number 8th group. And this is the last electron. The last electron of xenon is present in P subshell. The 6th electron, this is the one. The last electron, that is the valency electron of xenon, is present in P subshell. Then we can say it is the A subgroup. A subgroup. So simply we can say that xenon belongs to 8A group. 8A group. Of course, it is also known as 18th group. 8A group is also known as 18th group. So about this type of concept, we will study this concept in next chapter, that is periodic classification of elements. That will be told by our Ravi Kumar sir. So in the next chapter, you will discuss about these type of questions. Just I am remembering you here only, right? Okay. Yes, read the next question. Question number four. Read the question number four and see the options. Question number 4. Most electronegative element. Most electronegative element. What is the most electronegative element among the given electronic configurations? So first option given is, what is the first option given? 1s2, 2s2, 2p4, 3s1. First option, that is option A. Next option B, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p5. 3s2, 3p5. This is the valency shell configuration. Valency shell configuration is also called as outer shell electronic configuration. Next is C option, 1s2, 2s2, 2p5. What is the valency shell configuration here? 2s2, 2p5 is the valency shell configuration. Option D, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1, 3p8. Yes, my dear students, all of you know, 2p should be 6 because 3s is already given. So before 3s, 2p should be completely filled. But here 2p is not completely filled. So this is not the answer. And coming to the option D, after 3s, 3p is given. So before 3p, 3s should be completely filled. Here it is not completely filled. So this is not the option. So two options are removed. So finally, we are having only two more options. So among the two more options, now we are going to see option B and option C. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6. How many shells are present? In the option B, how many shells are present? How many shells are present in option B? First shell, second shell, third shell. For option B, 3 shells are present. For option C, how many shells are present? For option C, how many shells are present? 2 shells are present. It is the nucleus.
nucleus contain protons and neutrons. Nucleus is going to contain protons and neutrons. That means nucleus is going to contain which type of charge? Positive charge. The nucleus is going to contain positive charge. Valency is going to contain electron. Here, this is the nucleus containing positive charge. Valency is containing the electron. Now tell me, between the positive charge to electron, which type of forces are there? Between the positive charge to negative charge, which type of forces will be there? Between positive charge to negative charge, which type of forces will be there? In general, we can say that Coulombic force of attractions. Between positive and negative charges, Coulombic force of attractions, or weak electrostatic force of attractions, or simply attraction. In simple, attraction. Between positive charge and negative charge, attraction is there. Now tell me, in the option B and option C, where the attraction should be more? In the option B and option C, the positive charge is going to attract the electron here. Here the positive charge is going to attract the electron. Where the nucleus is going to strongly attract the electron? Where the nucleus is going to strongly attract the electron? Yes. In the option C, the nucleus is going to strongly attract the electron, because the distance between the nucleus to valence electron is less. So when the atomic size is less, this is a small size atom, this is a large size atom. When the atomic size is small, the nuclear attraction on the valence electron is more. This is a nucleus that is having attraction on the valence electron. Now the valence electron is strongly attracted by the nucleus. In which option nucleus is going to strongly attract the electron? Yes, in the option C. So the tendency to attract the electrons is the electron negativity. Once again, the tendency to attract the electrons is the electron negativity. The tendency to lose the electrons is called as electropositivity. The tendency to attract the electrons is called as electronegativity. So among the option B and option C, which is going to have more electronegativity? Among option B and option C, which is going to have more electronegativity? Yes. So which type of atoms are going to have more electronegativity? Which type of atoms are going to have more electronegativity? Small size atoms are going to have more electronegativity, right? Just one minute. Once again, option B and option C. Just tell me, in option B, how many total electrons are present? In option B, total, how many electrons are present in option B? Right, very good. In option C, total, how many electrons are present? In option C, total, how many electrons are present? Yes, tell me. Now, option B belongs to which element? Option B belongs to which element? Option B belongs to which element? Yes, correct, chlorine. Option B is indicating that is the chlorine. What is the symbol of chlorine? Cl. And option C is indicating? Yes, correct. Option C is indicating fluorine. The symbol of fluorine is F. Now, if we go to the electronegativity among the fluorine and chlorine, which one is more electronegative? Fluorine is more electronegative than chlorine. This will be asked in the first POC as well as in the second POC also, because in the second POC you are going to study about a chapter. In the second POC, you are going to study about the chapter halogens. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, they are called as halogens. Anyhow, so fluorine is going to have more electronegativity, chlorine is going to have less electronegativity. Small size atoms are going to have more electronegativity, large size atoms are going to have less electronegativity. So electronegativity electronegativity depends on
size of the atom. Electronegativity depends on
size of the atom. What is the relation between electronegativity and size of the atom? What is the electronegativity? What is the relation between electronegativity and size of the atom? It is inversely proportional. Inversely proportional. As the size of the atom increases, electronegativity decreases. My dear students, there is a relation between one chapter to another chapter. If you understand one chapter, then you can understand the next chapter. So that's why I'm requesting you, don't miss any of the class. If you are missing the class, one class, you are unable to understand properly the next topic, because all the topics are interrelated with each other. Right, anyhow, next question number. Yes, question number 5. Next question number 5. Read the question number 5. Read the question number 5 and tell me the option. Read the question number 5 and tell me the option. Question number 5. Yes, what is the question number 5 given? The element with electronic configuration. Question number 5 is the element with electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 3d10, 3s2, 3p6, 3d10, 4s1, 4s1, first shell, second shell, third shell, and it is the fourth shell. First shell is called as K shell, second shell is called as L shell, third shell is called as M shell, fourth shell is called as N shell. But to write the electronic configuration, we have to follow the Aufbau principle. We have to follow Aufbau principle. So if we are following the Aufbau principle, then we can write the electronic configuration as 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6. After 3p6, after 3p6, 4s. So 4s1, 3d10. Yes, all of you know, 4s1, 3d10. 4s1, 3d10 is indicating this is the electronic configuration of which element? Copper. What is the atomic number of copper? What is the atomic number of copper? Yes, correct. The atomic number of copper is 29. Yes, tell me, which of the principle is not obeyed by copper? We are having three principles. Aufbau principle, Hund's rule, Pauli's exclusion principle. Aufbau principle, Hund's rule, Pauli's exclusion principle. Which principle is not obeyed by copper? Yes, Hund's rule is not obeyed by copper. Is it correct? Is it correct? No. Which rule is not obeyed by copper? Which rule is not obeyed by copper? Aufbau principle is not obeyed by copper. According to Aufbau principle, 4s atoms are having lesser energy. The 4s atoms are having lesser energy than 3d atoms. Energies of orbitals. Energies of orbitals. 4s atoms are having lesser energy than 3d atoms. So according to Aufbau principle, always lower energy orbitals must be completely filled. The lower energy orbitals must be completely filled. That means 4s atoms must be completely filled. That means we have to write 4s2, 3d9. 4s2, 3d9 according to Aufbau principle. But to expect the stability, copper is not going to obey Aufbau principle. Then we can write the abnormal electronic configuration or anomalous electronic configuration of copper as 4s1, 3d10. Yes, you have to remember, copper is not going to obey Aufbau principle, right? Okay. So I am not saying only question and answer. Just I am saying not only question and answers. I am going in detail. I am explaining the topics again and again. Try to understand. Of course, chromium is also there, Bharat, but here the option is given. In this question, option is given. Option is not given. Right? Okay, fine. Okay, next question number 6. Read the question number 6. A 4f orbital has see the options. Orbitals are going to have nodes. What is meant by a node? The point at which the probability of finding an electron, the probability of finding an electron becomes very, very, very important word, node. What is the node? The point at which the probability of finding an electron becomes zero is called as a node. To calculate the number of nodes, see here, nucleus, first orbit, second orbit, third orbit, fourth orbit is there. And which orbital is given? 4f orbital is given. 4f orbital is given. For the 4f orbital, this is a radial node. This space is a radial node. This space is a radial node. And this space is also a radial node. That means in this spherical surface, we can't find the which electrons. In this spherical surface, we can't find the 4f electrons. In this spherical surface, we can't find the 4f electrons. In this spherical surface, we can't find the 4f electrons. Here only we can find the 4f electrons. So the spherical surfaces where we can't find the electrons, that is the radial node. Radial node, nothing but node. Node is nothing but radial node. Yes, what is the formula to calculate the radial nodes? What is the formula used to calculate the radial nodes? Yes, 4f, okay, fine, tell me. 4f orbitals are having how many number of nodes? 4f orbitals are having how many number of nodes? See this board. How many number of nodes are there for 4f orbitals? Yes, correct. 3 nodes are there for 4f orbitals. Yes, see here. 4f orbitals are having f orbitals. F orbitals starts from fourth shell. That means we can write 4f orbitals, next 5f orbitals, next 6f orbitals, and so on. 4f orbitals are having 3 nodes. Then tell me, 5f orbitals are having, very good. 5f orbitals are having 4 nodes. 6f orbitals are having 5 nodes. Very good answer. That means here 4 is there, here 3 is there. That means simply we can say that how many number of nodes are there? So number of nodes is equal to formula n minus 1. Yes, for 4f orbital n value is equal to 4. This is a 4. N value, principal quantum number value, is equal to 4 minus 1. That means n minus 1, that is equal to 4 minus 1, that is equal to 3. So we can say that 4f orbitals are having how many number of nodes? 4f orbitals are having 3 nodes. So to calculate the number of nodes, the formula is n minus 1. Question number 6, option C. Okay. Right. Next, question number 11. 12, Note down the questions, please. Note down the questions. Question number 11, 12, 15, 16, 18, next 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35. Are you noting these numbers? Are you getting note down these numbers? Are you getting note down these numbers? Okay, fine, ma. Fine, very good. 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40. Very simple. Those questions without calculation part. In simple, the questions without calculation part. You have to complete yourself. So total number of questions. How many questions are there in this topic? 116 questions are there. In your material, 116 questions are there. You have to solve yourself. And remaining part is there. That is calculation oriented. That means we have to substitute some formula. We have to do some calculations. In the next class, I will discuss those problems. So these problems, which are just based on concepts, try to solve yourself. If you are not getting the answer, and if you are unable to understand the concept, just text me that number. We will discuss in the evening. Right? What is the time? When we have to discuss? When we have to discuss? 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. Otherwise, if it is not 7 p.m. to 8 p.m., then it is 7:30 to 8:30. 7:30 to 8:30. Okay? Yes. Okay, fine, fine. Thank you. Thank you. So, okay, fine, ma. Fine. Thank you, one and all. So, can I close this session now? Do you practice these numbers? Can you practice these numbers? Yes. After practicing in your notes, please take a photograph and send it to my number. Okay? Thank you, one and all. Stay home, stay safe, have a nice day. This is your chemistry lecturer, Sachin Naidu. And you have to text your doubts or you have to call me on this number only. 9490283667. Right? Thank you, Ma. Thank you, one and all. Have a nice day.